Philip Caputo.
All right, Phil. Thank you so much. This is wonderful. We're sort of asking writers and, you know, people on the road here how it is they got started as writers. Most of the writers we've spoken with have these funny tales about how it is, and that they usually defy the myth of writers. The hand of God didn't come down and say, you shall write.
Gee, I almost feel like I should be compelled to defend the myth, because, I've always felt that one doesn't, people say, how do you become a writer, or I want to be a writer, or phrases like that. And I've often said that if you want to be a writer, you won't be, because most writers become writers because they have to be. It's something that's as natural to them as breathing, and almost as difficult to stop doing. So I can't say that there was some, I don't recall some moment of epiphany. I don't recall some Pauline moment when, as you say, the Lord came down from heaven. And, I do recall that an English teacher of mine in high school, as part of the American literature class we were taking, required us to write one short story and one, I think it was radio script or something like that, because he wanted us to know what goes into the creation of the things we were reading, the stories we were reading. I had really enjoyed it, and I had fun doing it.
Yeah. Do you remember what you wrote? Or what the topic was?
I do, actually. The story was, I was 16, you'll have to understand.
Of
so
course.
I was quite brave and decided I would write about something that I knew absolutely nothing about. And it was this rather Conradian tale about a murder that takes place on a plantation in Malaya, or Burma or some place. I think it was Burma, on the Irrawaddy River. And as I said, I had never been to Burma at age 16. As a matter of fact, I had hardly ever been to Wisconsin. I grew up in Illinois.
Yeah.
So, anyway, I remember I really liked that, but I was raised by my father to be an engineer, and all of my focus in high school and for the first 2 years of college was in engineering. And then I dropped out of college because I wasn't cut out to be an engineer, as I discovered, because I was flunking physics, calculus, and other essential engineering,
basic engineering
educational strong points. And so and when I went back to school, it was as an English major. That's what I tested out strongest in. And I started writing for the school newspaper, the school literary magazine.
In college,
yeah. And so, I don't know. Again, there was no grand moment, just something that was coming naturally to me. But I would say that...
But storytelling seems to have been...
Yeah.
An interest, if you were...
Well, I always liked to tell stories. I mean, if we were hanging around in a bar, I would probably tell you a story.
Yeah.
And I mean, it would be. I even dream in narratives. I wish, in fact, I could record some of my dreams. I'd become a great surrealistic writer. But I would say that as far as like professionally goes, the first two things I ever published outside of school were two war poems I had written in Vietnam.
And after you returned?
No, I was still there.
Still there and published.
And I published them in a one of those small literary magazines that was called the Midwestern Quarterly. Mm-hmm. And but when I got back from Vietnam, I remember feeling driven or compelled to write about the war. And it wouldn't let me go. Mm. Now, I wandered around quite a bit in Europe and in the States trying to write this book, and was getting nowhere. Eventually money ran out and so forth like that, and I got a job in a newspaper. And then...
How far along were you in the narrative by then?
Oh, I don't know that I was really anywhere, because the story had undergone a number of mutations. Mm-hmm. It began as a novel, then it was going to be a series of fictional sketches, then it was going to be a novel again, and finally around 1968, I was living in London, I remember, and I was reading some of Siegfried Sassoon, and he did a trilogy about World War I called Memoirs of an Infantry Officer. Mm. And that got me reading these great memoirs of World War I, many of which are now obscure, unfortunately. Well, it's certainly obscure in this country, maybe not so much in the UK. And I had this, that's when I had a moment. Yeah. I said that this story should really be a memoir and not a novel, but it should be a memoir that moves like a novel, that has the dramatic tension of a novel. But I ran out of money and so forth. And I went to work for a newspaper, and that was also in 68, and a small suburban paper in Chicago. And then I went to work for the Chicago Tribune, and I worked for them both in the States and overseas as a foreign correspondent for 9 years.
But you had not taken any journalism classes? Well, you would have, since you were on the school.
No, I didn't.
You hadn't.
No, I never. So, I never took a journalism course or... And I wasn't really, I was more like a kind of feature writer or feature columnist for the paper, the school paper. And that was the only experience I had. For what it's worth, I remember that when I went to interview at the Chicago Tribune, I now had this like 6 months or whatever it was, 8 months with this small suburban paper under my belt, but that wasn't much.
Yeah.
And I remember the executive editor of the Tribune asked me, he says, well, look, he says, you know, you have no formal training in this. You've got this little bit of experience. And what makes you think you can do this? And I said, well, I just think I can. I think I can work for the big city newspaper, you know. And he said, well, he says, I see you are an English major. And he says, so obviously you read a lot of Shakespeare. And I said, yeah, of course. And he says, well, and he says, you were in the Marine Corps. And I said, yeah. And then he says, well, so was I in World War II. And I said, right.
Semper Fi.
And he said, well, he says, you know, he says, we need people with a sense of the language. He says, journalism majors a lot of times don't have that. And he hired me on the basis that I had read Shakespeare and that I'd been in the Marine Corps. That was how I got to be a newspaper man.
At that point, Your book, Rumor of War, still in its infancy, right?
Yeah. And now I worked on it for the next 9 months, 9 years. No, and when I say worked on, I don't mean I worked on it for 9 years every day.
Right.
I hardly sometimes worked on it for every even month,
right.
Because I put in very long hours with the paper, and I had precious little time to work on the book. And but by 1973 or 4 or something like 74, I think it was, I had about 100 pages that I was happy with, and sent them through a friend to an agent, and lo, he sold them. He sold it.
Do you remember getting that word? Do you remember what it felt like?
Yeah. It was, I was quite flabbergasted, stunned, yeah. Actually, because I, at that time, that subject of Vietnam was anathema.
Yeah.
Nobody wanted to hear about it. Nobody wanted to read about it. As a matter of fact, that my editor at Henry Holt & Company at the time, Marion Wood, said that when the manuscript landed on her desk, she refused to look at it for 3 weeks. Mm. She says, I'm not going to read something about that goddamned war, you know, kind of thing. And but she eventually, her conscience got to her. She said, this kid is probably, although I wasn't that much of a kid at that point, and is probably waiting to hear from me. And anyway, she was quite taken with it. And so...
And by that point, weren't you also covering Vietnam?
Well, I had covered the fall of Saigon. I'm trying to remember now. My chronology is off. If I got the acceptance before I covered the fall of Saigon or afterward, I suspect it was afterward, maybe. So maybe I'm talking 1975.
Somewhere, yeah.
Yeah. And I know I remember finishing the book in 76, and then it was published in 77.
Yeah. Apart from Rumor Roar, was there ever a newspaper story that you did that you can remember as being something very unique or very special, or, you know, the breaking story that you felt super proud of, perhaps your first one, or is there ever any of those?
A newspaper. Well,
byline stories.
I mean, I was an investigative reporter for about 4 years for the Tribune. I was actually with an investigative team
that
won a Pulitzer. And so I'm proudest of that as a journalistic effort, but that was a team effort.
Right.
I'm proud of what we did and very pleased with what we did. We really did clean up Chicago elections to the point that even today, believe it or not, Chicago elections are actually held up as a model of probity, civic probity. And
are we talking Daley here?
Well, we're talking about Daley the Younger. But we did ours during the reign of Daley the Elder. And those were rough and tumble days. As far as though as an unusual or story that I did all on my own, I remember one I did when I covered the Arab-Israeli War in 73, and I was at a burial service for a number of Israeli paratroopers that were killed and had been killed in action. It was this very, very moving ceremony, not in its formality or its beauty, but almost the opposite. It was very raw. Mothers of these paratroopers were there, you know, crying out in Hebrew to the heavens and flinging themselves on these fresh graves. And the rabbi was singing the Kadesh, you know, the Hebrew prayer of the dead. And and it was the rawness of it. And I remember being probably more moved emotionally by any story I had ever come across. I was shaken by this. And when I went back to my hotel room, I remember being in a state of almost trance-like state, writing this story. And it was a very unconventional kind of newspaper story.
Yeah.
And I filed it through the telex, which is what we used to do in those ancient times now. And I remember thinking, I wonder if the paper's even going to run this weird thing. Yeah. And they were just crazy about it. They loved it. I got a bonus from the editor for it, you know, like that. And I got a couple of small awards for the story. Minor, you know, really minor awards. I so minor that I don't even remember what they were. But yeah. They were. And I think that as a literary effort that was at the same time journalism, I remember that one the most clearly.
You're writing column inches at the Chicago Trib.
Right.
And you've got one book just about or did come out. And you must be starting to think about subsequent books.
Yeah, I wasn't ready.
And if I recall, your second one was fiction, right?
Yeah, it was a novel, Horn of Africa.
Yeah.
And which was loosely inspired by an assignment I had had in East Africa. A journalist, a newspaper assignment that I had gone on. And what happened there was that first of all, Rumor of War, as I said, was published in 77. By that point, I was the Moscow correspondent for the paper. And in those days of the Cold War, to be the Moscow correspondent for anybody, there were only like maybe a dozen of us all together. For the New York Times, Washington Post, Chicago Tribune, AP, UPI, U.S. News and World Report, Newsweek, Time, maybe 15. So it was a very elite corps, and to be the Moscow correspondent was regarded then as the pinnacle of the foreign correspondent's career. But I had this idea for this novel that I really, really wanted to write. And Rumor of War was successful beyond anything I ever could have imagined.
Yeah.
So I had a lot of, as we'd say today, street creds with the publisher. So I wrote a synopsis of the novel, and I already had about 40 or 50 pages of it written, wrote a synopsis, the rest of it, sent it off to Holt, and they really loved it. They said, we want you to write it, and they gave me, for what was at that time, a pretty generous advance. But as a Moscow correspondent, it wasn't like you had scuds of free time. You had almost no free time.
Yeah. Because
when you weren't covering something in the Soviet Union, you were going to these required diplomatic and journalistic functions where you met sources and, you were working the rooms, so to speak. So I wrote to the foreign editor and I said that I wanted could I get a leave of absence to finish the book? And he said, no, can't do it. He says, this is a big job. This is not like, we're going to move somebody in there for 6 months or a year while you write your book and then you move back in and that won't work. So I said, okay, I quit.
Incredible.
And so I did.
Moscow beat. Right during the start of her strike.
It was before. It was
before that.
This was the depths of the Cold War. This was Leonid Brezhnev.
Oh, Brezhnev.
It was during the period of so-called detente.
Yeah.
And the period of the dissonance.
Yeah.
But it was pretty bleak. Time, but interesting from a journalistic point of view, So that's what happened.
So was that your last newspaper assignment?
Yeah, I've written for papers since then.
Yeah,
but the Times has called me up, the Washington Post, even my old alma mater, Boston Globe. But as an actual staff writer, staff correspondent. Covering hard breaking news. No, that was my last gig.
What a way to go!
Yeah, it wasn't.
That's pretty cool.
Right? Yeah.
Has your writing habit changed any? How do you go about writing?
You mean what is my routine? I've generally got one, but it often depends on where I am.
Yeah,
I live half the year, not even half the year, 4 months of the year I live in Arizona during the winter,
right.
And the other 8 months I live in the East Coast in Connecticut. And so I will confine myself for the moment to the East Coast.
Okay.
And there it's stunningly boring in its predictability, my routine. I'm almost embarrassed at how, shall we say, bourgeois normal it is. But, I like the myth of the crazed writer Jack Kerouac, you know, whacking down speed and writing on the road in 3 days or something like that. So I'm usually up pretty early, about 6:30. And I feed the dog, I make coffee. I do about 20 minutes of stretching exercises and calisthenics. Then I have there a separate writing studio, a detached cottage from the house. And I walk over to the cottage and then I start, or I attempt to start, because sometimes nothing happens.
Yeah.
I follow that routine. I mean, some of the routine is even down to small things. Like after doing my stretching exercises, I have to shave.
Uh-huh.
I must shave. Then I must have another cup of coffee, you know, and I have to do these things. If I don't do them, everything feels out of sorts. I feel out of sorts.
Yes.
And it's almost like a baseball player on a hitting streak who doesn't change his underwear or something like that.
Right.
I heard about that, you know. Glad I didn't know the guy.
Well, do you use a computer for much of your research now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, almost all of it.
Yeah.
I had had a wonderful Encyclopedia Britannica. I'm in the hardcover print version.
Right.
And
it's funny you had to explain that. You know, the hardcover.
Yeah, no, yeah, I know.
Because there's a lot of people that don't know what that is.
And about 2 years ago, there was a ferocious storm on the East Coast, and this giant pine tree fell on my studio and crushed it like a Kleenex box and destroyed all sorts of stuff in it, including my Encyclopedia Britannica.
Yeah.
So, insurance, you know, paid me back for a lot of that, and then the studio was rebuilt. But I realized that I don't need that encyclopedia with Google.
Yeah.
And I don't even need to go to the library anymore. That, in some ways, that bothers me. You know, I'm troubled, especially by not using the library.
Yeah.
Because I believe in libraries, and I believe that they're important community institutions, but it's just so easy. I mean, I just go and what amazes me is you take, like, the last novel I wrote was set on the Arizona border, part of it in the past, in the early 20th century, during the just before the Mexican Revolution to just after the Mexican Revolution, and part of it was set in the present. Well, I was writing one of the historical passages, which takes place in Sonora, Mexico, during a campaign, a guerrilla campaign during the Mexican War, and I wanted to I want to know something about the Mexican revolutionary song that were sung.
Yeah.
Because I remember once hearing one, many years after it, called Adelita. And what amazes me, so I go to Google, I go, Mexican revolutionary songs. know, there's, you know, 5,000 choices, you know, right. The lyrics, the music, you know, actual recordings of people singing these right. songs. And it was, well, you just can't beat that.
No. Do you ever get asked to give a class or talk to prospective writers, young writers?
All the time.
What are your rules? What do you tell? What's first and foremost then when they say, I want to be a writer?
Well, as I said earlier, I do tell them, I said, if you want to be a writer, you probably will not be.
Mm-hmm.
It is something that you have to do. And I use an old-fashioned word, being a boy educated by nuns and Jesuit priests. I said, it is a vocation. I said, it really is a calling. It's not a profession. It's not like, I want to be a lawyer, I want to be a doctor,
yeah.
Or whatever. I want to be a teacher. And it's not anything you can transition into from something else. I remember once in Florida, and I think it was at the University of Miami, University of Miami asked me to give a little talk.
Yeah.
I think it was actually, I was supposed to talk to an American studies class about a rumor of war and the Vietnam War in general, and then talk to a writing class, creative writing class. Mm-hmm. And so at this class, but I didn't say a word. I walked in. I didn't say a thing.
Yeah.
And it was at one of those graduate level seminars with about maybe 12 people in it or something like that. And I just started writing names of writers on there. You know, like I'd say Herman Melville, Edgar Allan Poe. I don't quite recall who else, you know. And but I had about 12 names on there, you know, and I said, I said, so here, I said, we have Herman Melville. I said, treated like a rock star, I said, after he wrote Taipei, and thinking of blood type, I guess. I said, was one of the most popular novelists in America, and I said, died in such total obscurity that the New York Times misspelled his name in its brief obituary. And I said, Edgar Allan Poe, I said, alcoholic, drug addict.
Yeah.
And, you know, went up the list as an Ernest Hemingway, you know, alcoholic, committed suicide. William Faulkner, died early, alcoholic. And went through this list of woes, and I said, now, who here still wants to be a writer? And this, some of them, and the first one, I think they ended up all raising their hands, yeah. But the first one to raise their hands was this woman of a certain age. I mean, she was, you know, maybe 50.
Yeah.
And I said, you, madam, will be a writer. I said, because you are obviously crazy already.
Right. Do you think there's a future for writing in America, given these technology and cultural changes that are seem to have such an impact on us and our attention span?
I don't know. But the mere fact that I say I don't know shows that there's really a real doubt in my mind. That there is much of a future for literature as we have known it.
Yes.
It often seems impossible to me that there is going to be a future for it. When I look at some of my, when I look at some of my, say my niece or and her friends, all of whom are very bright, and all that, but they don't really read, except what they have to read in school,
or what they read online,
and certainly, and then if you get to people that, you know, are just kind of like more ordinary people than they, I mean, these are kids who are going to Stanford and places like that.
Right.
I don't think that they I noticed that they don't even read newspapers anymore.
Read newspapers?
I mean, and I'm including newspapers online.
Yeah.
And I've seen studies and surveys that prove that out.
Yeah.
That below a certain age group, and I think it's like 35 or something like that, they won't even read online journalism. And I see them on airplanes. I see them on the train going into New York City. They're playing computer games. Mm-hmm. They're watching movies on the computer. Mm-hmm. And so it doesn't... And the whole society seems as though its trend is toward ever more social fragmentation, ever more super specialization in what you do, and to use another TION word, and more and more kind of an isolation.
Yeah.
People don't engage one another the way they used to. I mean, all that said, I've also been asked to participate in any number of literary festivals and book festivals around the country.
There are many.
Oh, they're all over the place.
For me, one of the things I see is less and less reading of literature, but more and more desire to write literature. Everybody seems to have a novel.
Yeah, I know. Isn't that... That's one of the peculiar things I've noticed, is, and I've been to these book festivals in Tucson, in Miami, in New Orleans, yeah, in Chicago, in Key West, Florida. I can't even remember some of the smaller ones. And thousands of people show up at these things. Yeah. The Tucson Book Festival, Tucson, Arizona.
Tell me about this.
It's only 3 years old, or maybe four. I don't recall which, but I know it's no older than that, no older than four. And almost overnight, it became the largest book festival, the third largest book festival in America. And I think in 4 day or a 3 day weekend, it goes is the length of the venue.
Mm-hmm.
50,000 people. Jeez. Showed up for this thing, and both all 3 years,
yeah,
each year 50,000 people. Now, and a lot of them are wannabe writers, so I can't explain that paradox. But I do think that if there is a future in narrative writing, it's going to be different than anything we've ever known. I think that this technology would produce a new form, mm-hmm, of writing, a new way of writing. I can't define it beyond any way beyond that. But the analogy I'm thinking of is that of the printing press.
Oh yeah.
What was that? 500 years ago,
yeah,
roughly speaking. And so before that, one had long narrative works of literature, generally epic poems or narrative poems or the Icelandic sagas, which were carefully inscribed, right, by hand, on at first on scrolls and then in these hand-bound books that were read obviously only by the literate, which was probably 0.001% of the entire population. So then the printing press came along, and not only were you able to print and widely distribute these Virgil and Homer and Beowulf,
right,
and the Song of Roland and the Bible, the, yeah, longest narrative, yeah, of all. But in time, it took, well over a century. In time, by democratizing literature and reading, it gave form to the novel.
Yeah.
I mean, I think the novel was a basically a kind of middle class art form. Mm-hmm. It wasn't for the very, very small, narrow, well-educated, aristocratic mm-hmm. elite. And electronic media have taken democracy even further, even to the point that I would say it approaches, if it does not cross into, anarchy.
That's right.
But that's bound. It's bound eventually to create some new way of writing and expressing oneself that we really haven't seen yet, and we really can't define yet. But we'll know it when we see it, when it comes. I'm not talking about e-books.
No.
An e-book is just simply a print novel in electronic form. And personally, as an old-fashioned, now dinosaur novelist,
yeah.
I don't give a damn if, to tell you the truth, if mine are printed, if they're on a, you know, on a screen, on a Kindle.
Yeah.
As long as somebody reads them.
Right.
Yes, maybe I favor the hardcover printed because I think they're attractive. I like the smell of them. I like the tactility of it all. But what I'm saying is that there won't be like an e-novel. It's going to be something different. We don't even have a name for it yet.
Yeah.
I mean, we talk the novel, the short story, the epic poem, the narrative poem, the vignette. We have 1,000 different names. This is some form, I think, that that the technology itself will give birth to. Just like maybe the journalistic equivalent is, who the hell 5 years ago, or maybe it's 10 now, whoever heard of the word blog?
Right.
We have a blog. That's now a recognized journalistic form.
Well, Phil, we're at the end of the tape.
Okay.
I really want to thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome.
Agreeing
you're welcome
to do this and share your insights.
It was a pleasure.
It has been a kick. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.